was just there wasn't a lot of hype.
I mean,
for
I fully
team.
Expect them to get into the LCS. So
I mean, if they do lose to Origin, they will play on Sunday against the loser of this game as well. So definitely have another chance, no matter what happens today. Let's get into our game, though, Pulse.
Let's do it, Deficio. We have those bans coming through. The Tamkent once again up against Schalke. Right here, Nidalee Ryze will be finishing off the bans from ROCCAT. Alistair Malzahar, Gangplank, gonna get a quick prediction. First pick from ROCCAT.
Oh, Vladimir.
That's not a prediction. You already got locked into Fischio.
That's how I predict stuff. I wait for him to lock it and be like, I think Vladimir. Oh, no. Okay. No, I'll do the classic. Ah, yeah, Vladimir. I expected Vladimir. I didn't get to say it in time, but I expected the Vladimir. I was about to say it, but you were talking. Mm-hmm. I was tapping on the table for you to stop talking so I could predict the Vladimir.
That's why there was that pause. Yeah.
But here he is, the Vladimir.
Explain. So why the Vladimir first?
As predicted, well, first of all, Betsy in team fights in the last game was a monster. Mm-hmm. Second of all, I think Betsy showed yesterday that he's maybe not too comfortable in all the mid lane matchups he had in there in terms of his champion pull. Like, he tried to pull out the Sona. We saw the Swain a few times as like a counter pick. I think getting a staple control mage that Schalke likes to play as well makes perfect sense. And much like last game, it often ends in big team fights where the Vladimir is just fantastic. So I think it's a fine first pick. Only concern is always giving Karma. But because Schalke is not going Karma Sivir, it's not the end of the world.
Yeah.
Like, giving Karma Lucian, I think is okay if you're ROCCAT. Play Sivir yourself, buff up the Vladimir. Party time.
But there's the Lucian, there's the Karma for Schalke. Now we're waiting on ROCCAT. I would love to see a Riven, but I don't think we're going to see it today, unfortunately.
But
Because if we're going to see a pocket pick, it will probably be Jace.
Right. If you're ROCCAT here, though, why not do what you did last game? Go Gragas again, and then you can either lock in like your Gangplank if you want to show early solo lane. So not Gangplank, he's actually banned in this one. But then you can lock in. I would like go Sivir Gragas. And you just have like a super strong team fighting composition. Jhin is okay as well. I'm not against it. It's a comfort pick. I like the Gragas because you want to see Schalke be proactive in the early game and actually punish you for picking scaling before you change. If Gilius locks in his Elise again, forms like the Gragas and doesn't really do a whole lot, well, already at level 6, Memento is basically getting the advantage. I'm like, great, you didn't do anything pre-level 6. I'm now level 6 on Gragas. I can gank. I can team fight. I can outscale you. Awesome. So I think ROCCAT should just continue this late game trend until Schalke shows a better early game.
And from Schalke,
I was actually looking at this earlier, being like, okay, Schalke likes to play with control in mid lane. And one of the picks that offer a lot of control in mid is Talia. Mm. Because she's so good in the laning phase. She's basically a Twisted Fate with a strong laning phase. Because she can actually push the lane so effectively early game, and then she can roam to side lanes with her ulti like a TF can do. So I was hoping we got to see it, and I'm actually glad we get to see it now. This again signals strong early game from Schalke. Karma Lucian, great 2v2 lane. Talia, fantastic laner. Elise, much better early game jungler than Gragas. If Schalke cannot be proactive and win the early game with this kind of composition, they will lose 0-3.
Because this is very similar to what they were running last time in that last game.
Just better mid laner in terms of early game compared to Kassadin.
Even better.
You can gank for the Talia really easily. So you can set it up with a knockback. There's a lot of good things for Schalke early game wise. But as you said, we highlighted that last game. Yep. They didn't use it.
Now we just need to see the execution coming into the second game. That's really where it lies.
Yeah, now we can just go Gnar again for Steve.
Yep.
Up in the top lane against the Shen. And you have winning lanes across the entire map.
I mean, Shen is a very, very neutral matchup for most top laners because Shen's never going to win the lane. He'll just go, like, even. He'll just make you go even. The Orianna of top lane. Yeah. Thresh as well for bottom lane.
But just take the Gnar so you have the pressure in the lane.
Sure.
And you just have the range advantage. You can just push into Shen as much as possible. Other picks, I mean, Relia is not great into Shen. You don't want to do that.
Actually, Relia is quite bad into
Shen. You definitely don't want to do that. Other top lane picks we have in the current meta, you know, things like Malzahar, he's obviously banned in this case, Gangplank's banned in this case, so Gnar is the pick I think you should just go for and just have this super strong setup. ROCCAT with the Thresh. Oh, okay. They actually go Fiora here to try and, that's fine, okay. I can take it as well, I can accept it. I would have liked Gnar for just better team fighting, but we see the split pushing composition from Schalke instead. And Parenk did struggle in his first game yesterday against the Fiora.
That's true.
But ROCCAT once again running heavy team fight, strong, strong tanks. And a lot of damage coming from Betsy.
Yeah.
Where Schalke is very spread out, you know, damage top laner, damage mid, damage shady carry. Some split pushing components in here. Not the greatest team fight in the world by any means.
But the potential to get ahead early.
Definitely
and
so.
For Gilius to set everyone up. This is game one, round two that we need to see from Schalke. And completely right. We see it's a very easy statement to be like, if they lose this game, very easy for them to go 0-3. But in terms of mentality, in terms of what they're running, and in terms of like how they're meant to run it, it becomes more and more of a valid statement as we come into game two here between these two teams. And I was expecting this to definitely go to Schalke. I wasn't even expecting a game to go to ROCCAT based on yesterday's performances.
Let's see. Schalke have the superior early game. ROCCAT, though, I mean, it's not bad lanes to have. Shen is a good laner. You know, you have range support with Jhin in the bottom lane. We're still favorite over to Schalke with stronger AD carry matchup. Also stronger support matchup, unless Raze goes crazy. But
I mean, there's always the potential with every hook onto the perfect target at the perfect time.
Definitely lane swap if I was ROCCAT in this game.
Okay. Well, they tried it last time, and it was read out by Schalke with their early invade. Let's get into a game two here, Schalke and ROCCAT. Let's see if Schalke read that lane swap, because they did it last time, and that was step one. We need to get to step two now for Schalke. It's baby steps. And Steve going to be in the top lane for now. Karan goes up there as well. And Fox, he's rock surfing. He's having a good time.
My favorite thing, Pulse, is when you start play-by-playing level ones. Mm-hmm. He's hitting the ward.
Sometimes they do interesting things. It's just like, is he going to do a dance?
Oh, wait, Memento's waiting in the bush here.
Take it away, Diffish. You didn't even need
there
me.
There we go. Steel back and Raze walking in their own jungle into another bush near the Raptor. Pulse has actually left the caster desk. I am now alone. They high five Parang and Memento on the way. There you go. That is my play-by-play
awesome.
Of the level one. And we get a lane swap for ROCCAT. So good for them. Schalke didn't fully invade like last game. Classic on ROCCAT. You start on bottom side. You wait a bit. No one invades. And then you just kind of blind swap to top side and try and see if there's a chance you get the lane swap. And they do. So good for them. Sadly for you guys at home, this might be one of the last lane swaps you will see. In a long time, at least this kind of lane swap, because we are getting so
lane swap
close.
As we know it.
We're getting so close to the next patch.
Yep.
And then...
Well, lane swaps are kill.
They will die.
Hello, Raze. How much can he do here? He's going to be annoying. Sometimes you get the support doing
something
crazy.
You got to be careful, though. When the guy gets
dying.
Red buff, you don't want to be here.
Raze, you need to get out. You need to get towards that Baron wall so you can flash over. But Gilius and Steve back away, so almost had a heart attack there.
Yeah, so due to Gilius and Steve not having any AoE, they didn't have the small spiderlings low. They couldn't kill the spiderlings with the red buff, and they get level 2 on Elise, because then they could suddenly chase and actually force a flash from the support. Raze stayed around. So, Talia, much, much different pick in this game here from Schalke compared to the Kassadin. Mm. Talia can push almost every lane level 1, even against control mages, just Q spam on these minions. It is so much damage from one single ability. Because minions don't juke.
Yeah.
So it's very easy to hit every single one on them, as long as you're not on this annoying worked ground. And you just perma-push, honestly. You perma-push, force them to see us on the tower, and then you ward your sides.
Yeah.
Please ward your sides.
That's what we're hoping for this time. But I'm also hoping for Gilius to get involved this time around. But of course it's going to take a little bit just because of how the lane swap is working out. We may see the junglers come into the mid lane because that's one of the few things that they can do. So we might see them do that. But for now, Fox is going to keep on pushing.
Oh, waste a lot of mana there, missing his combo. That is basically what Betsy has as the advantage. No mana for him trying to out-sustain the Talia. Burn through her mana. If you can get it to go back before she gets Lost Chapter, you actually get a much easier time in lane, because Lost Chapter is such a broken item. It gives so much extra mana regen for you, so if you get it on first back, great. You just keep pushing, you get your level up, you get your mana back, you can keep playing aggressive. If you force it back like this actually before, you have to worry about your mana just a little bit, So when you saw the Talia Mishra combo before, well, once you're out of mana, you're not going to perma-push. Vladimir's just going to farm. You know, he's going to be fine. He's building early MR. So good for Betsy that he dodged around the combo, and Talia didn't get to get the lost chapter. One of my favorite items in the game.
Really?
It's actually insane how good it is.
Do you play a lot of mid lane nowadays, Deficio? I know you played a lot of ADC.
I only play
the Jhin and the Twitch.
No, yeah. I only play Twitch.
You were the Jhin one trick into the Twitch one trick.
Yeah, but yeah. I lost a lot of games on Jhin because skill shots are really hard to hit.
I was in a lot of those.
Yeah, I tried. But again, for some reason, skill shots are not point and click abilities. Mm. I thought they were.
Right.
So I realized with my caster mechanics, Twitch is better.
Yeah.
Because Twitch has like one skill shot and is like a circle anyway. It's really, really hard to miss this W.
But
I love the sound effects on Twitch.
The sound effects on Talia, they sound pretty good. Memento also had to dash through that E field. And that, of course, detonates them. Does less damage now because Talia had some changes where each consecutive E does a little bit less damage. Each little...
Ooh!
Parang's only level 2 and they're both level 4. He'll have to flash over the wall. So nice early flash taken away from Parang.
See, because we suddenly talked about my fantastic Twitch, we actually missed what happened in the lane swap here. After the first towers went down, ROCCAT has returned to the top lane with their dual lane. While Schalke just gets a free push on bottom side, and they want to try and punish Parang and not let him pick up all this juicy, juicy farm. Everyone is down here. Quite a time in the bot lane.
It's like you bring Memento, we'll bring two more people, continue pushing you away from this tower. There's only one minion remaining though, so Schalke aren't going to take away this tower on this initial push, but there is another minion wave coming in, and everyone is committed.
Why
it does
on earth?
Mean that in the top lane, Steelback is able to get this push down by himself, so he's having a jolly good old time here, Deficio, just farming away, and now Schalke are going to back off.
Pulse. Very interesting how ROCCAT, after seeing the Lucian Karma on top side after T1 towers went down, sent their dual lane back up to their top lane. Also because Steep was pushing his lane, so they're like, oh, we can get a free lane here for Parang, he can pick up a lot of farm, and then we go top, but the problem is you end up losing a lot of time when you have to recall again as a dual lane, walk topside. Betsy taking some damage in mid, doesn't really matter a whole lot, he can't sustain it back, and now the raid boss, Memento, the carry of game one, the slayer of Kassadin.
He's not quite a raid boss just yet. Last game he was very huge. Right now he's just... he's just a minion.
Just a minion for now?
Not a League of Legends minion, but like in a raid, he would be one of like the side, or maybe one of the summons, the adds.
Wouldn't he just be like, not the end boss, but like the first boss?
Oh,
first
right,
boss
okay.
is so easy anyway. Like no one has ever had issues with the first boss, unless you play vanilla World of Warcraft, and obviously you had in Blackwing Lair. Uh-huh. The very first boss, Razorgore, I remember his name. When you have to control the egg, oh my god. Like. I don't know how hard that was for someone, but you could wipe and wipe and wipe for years because of one guy failing the AWP over and over.
With pick-up groups, it was just the worst. Always with the first boss in like any raid, people just don't understand. It's just like you really just need to do like one mechanic the boss has. Just one mechanic. Like Gragas right there. It's like here's one mechanic. He's going to come in. He's going to flash EU. All you need to do is play around that. Oh, you didn't play around it. We wiped.
Don't stand in the AoE on the ground. If you can see his barrel on the ground, don't stand in it. Move out of it. It's pretty damn simple. Pretty damn simple, Pulse. That's what we need here. We need add-ons, League of Legends, like warnings. Like, warning.
I mean, there are warnings. Like you have the target indicators, like on the floor. You have time to react.
Oh, that's fair. But you need like something that blinks in your screen and like yells in your ears.
Oh,
and,
I see.
Well, you those are would standing be your and stuff. Move.
Those would be your friends on TeamSpeak yelling at you.
See, there we go. Lost chapter is completed.
Best
for Talia. Time to push that mid lane.
He's already been doing it, but now it means he can keep it up. Keep on pushing the mid lane.
Yeah, but he's not been able to get extra
and,
pressure.
Push and then roam, but no, he hasn't really roamed anywhere. No. Gideus as well hasn't really ganked anywhere just yet.
Well, to be fair, it was a lane swap that ended up in a push on bottom side. Didn't get a tower. Gideus with the first invade of the day. He finds Memento. Don't stand in the circle. We're talking about it.
Setting. There we go. He's got those raid mechanics.
Just don't stand in the fire.
He's still sticking around, but he's got top pushing and mid pushing and foxes rotating, so he has priority over this boo buff, so he was just taken away from Gragas. And Memento knew that, so he just backs off to the mid lane, recalls, knew it was just a waste of time. And Schalke also invading the red buff, taking everything away from poor Memento.
But this is also because ROCCAT had this really weird call early in the swap where they went to topside. after seeing the dual lane up there, first of all, you don't even want standard lane specifically. Yeah, okay, there was a wave pushing for Parang, but you having to recall from bottom side as an AD carry support, walk all the way to top side, buy so much time for Schalke to make the next move, and that's why they could push for that bottom lane, send four members down and deny a lot of farm from Parang. Now they can push it in again. That's what you just saw with Rallis and Spuddle. Here's the first
Weavers
gank on the side
wall.
Lane.
Doesn't quite cut off Parang. Gets in range though just to say hi.
That
and then he'll back
terrible.
Away. That was a lot less inspiring than I was expecting it to be, quite honestly.
Yeah, I mean, he got pretty far ahead of the rest of the team. Parang would have been able to taunt and flash if needed.
Yeah.
Probably would never have killed him, but at least, I mean, you could hit a skill shot.
I mean, even if he hit the skill shot, it didn't matter. They weren't picking up the kill. But for style points, for integrity at least, it doesn't matter. Schalke still take the top tower, yeah. So we got something from it.
We see the cross map. One thing, again, I like that you learn very quickly in the LCS is when your team makes a play on one side, mm-hmm. you better get out of the way on the other side of the map.
Yeah.
Memento showed up in the bottom lane. Rallis, Spraddle recalls or steps away because they were going to lose tower. Had they stayed, Gragas would have dove them with Shen ulti on. They would have died. We would have blamed them. No one would be happy. People at home would start crying. It wouldn't be great. Much better if you just back away, give them tower, trade tower for tower.
Mm-hmm. That's all we need. And then the game is, for the most part, even. And again, this is to be expected from LCS teams. Just go even in the early game. Where so often in Challenger, we see teams like one team execute the lane swap pretty decently, the other team just making a misstep and then falling behind, or both teams making a misstep. It's a lot more volatile in Challenger, so I'd like to find out what's happening if the other stream goes over to a lane swap as well, with Misfit and Origin, if anything opens up. But for now, we're back in Schalke.
Don't tell
and
them about
Rocket.
It.
I don't know what's happening. I'm making guesses.
We want people to watch our game.
Yeah, that's why I drew it back to current action.
Yeah, I can announce that nothing is happening on the other stream. There have been zero kills. Nothing is going on. This game is way more exciting, guys. Definitely watch this game with me and Pulse.
Yeah, you're our family.
Yeah, like, we are basically a family.
Through all of the adversity, you chose to stick with us instead of watching the new hotness, you know, Origin and Misfits.
Old and
it's
steady.
Like you were talking
old
about the casters.
Steady.
Old and steady. Betsy, he's coming in here. Nice taunt onto Fox. Gilead doesn't quite get tagged up, but a Hema Plague as well. The body slam and the first blood coming out from Memento. Parang getting off to tower. Deadly Flush coming across. Gilead's getting chased down as well. Hello, two kills, ROCCAT.
Oh, it's painful to watch the mistakes, honestly, from Schalke in the early game. We have the same setup as last game where Schalke much stronger early on in the game. Should be able to get an advantage early on in the game. And then now they completely fail in the mid lane. Great setup from ROCCAT again. Betsy just calls for the Shen ulti and walks in behind Schalke. And then they pick up both a kill on Gillis and Fox at the same time. And now you get a mid tower as well. This is suddenly looking really bad again for Schalke. Down a tower, down in kills, down in gold. Look at the setup, it's just Betsy hiding in the bush with Shen ulti on. Like, it's not even like a fancy setup or anything. Catch out Schalke, Gilius thinks he can get the last executing on Parang, which is an auto attack. Ends up using his flash aggressively instead of defensively, and goes down. Would probably have died no matter what, because they could have chased for him.
Yep.
But honestly, almost too easy, and Betsy, again, picking up early kills.
Man, ROCCAT again getting ahead in this game. What was it? Who was it on the analyst team? I think Mickey said it was going to be 3-0 to ROCCAT.
So Schalke, he said.
Oh, really? Oh, I wanted to praise him. He was like, 3-0, and I was like, oh, really?
Now you can flame him.
Yeah, now I can. Now I can do that. Rip in peace. ROCCAT, two kills in this early game. Again, getting an advantage. 2,000 gold. And again, we said this was game one, round two, at least I did. Schalke, strong lanes, even maybe better this time with Talir in the mid lane. Again, Gilius on his priority jungler, and they're behind.
Yeah, obviously lane swap didn't really benefit Schalke specifically just because they didn't get to use their lanes. They ended up slightly winning the lane swap after the way ROCCAT played it. But then after, with this mid lane setup from ROCCAT, well, suddenly they're now in the driving seat. Again, like last game. Betsy, he's going to be very strong under Vladimir, we know that. Gragas, fantastic team fighter, outskills the Elise. Fiora, on the other hand, fantastic late game. So it's not like Schalke have no tools in the late game at all. They just spike really hard on like two items across mid and AD carry. Steve wants like three items on Fjord, and he can take over the top lane completely. Even before that, he will have an advantage. Problem for him is, like last game, if your mid and bot lane is losing, being that one split pusher, that single split pusher, it really doesn't do a whole lot, because whenever you push past the river, you kind of have to be like, oh, do I want to push further? Can the enemy team like roam up behind me and kill me? And then you end up just backing away and playing very passive. And then you don't get to really utilize a Rift Herald Fiora in the late game. So Schalke need one of these other lanes to be at least even with ROCCAT. And that means no more mistakes. Don't fall further behind and you still have a chance to win the game.
Yeah.
One bad dragon fight, Pulse.
Not all out the window just yet. Yeah, one bad dragon fight. And we can see exactly what happened in game one. Honestly, it was a 4-for-1 trade for ROCCAT. And Schalke just couldn't recover from there. So don't have that happen again. And could still be in a chance of
they're gonna catch Spraddle here.
This series.
They find him in the pit.
I think Spraddle's just going to ult. No, he's going to walk into Memento. Rallis is there as well. Here comes the TP on top of him from Parang. Betsy also coming into the fight. Ray is coming in there. Doesn't really need to do anything. He walks up to try an auto-attack, and they're already dead. Two more kills, and tagging off Rallis to the back of the fight. Firing off another one to see if he can find Fox. And Raze is coming in, the flashy moves coming out of the play as well. Memento going to flash away. He is taking down from the Ignite, and that will be a 1-for-1 in the end.
And so a 3-for-1. Really like the setup again, just hiding on a pink ward here. Schalke had no control in the river. And when they tried to set up vision, well, there was a Gragas right in front of you with a Shen ulti on. Fight starts, ROCCAT wins another fight in the mid lane. Around the mid lane, we should say, instead. Much like last game, like last game all over again. Gank around mid lane for first few kills. Fight in the river, where Schalke have no control in the river, and they walk into it to try and get that control, and ROCCAT punish them. Another game where Memento is part of everything, basically. Always in the right place at the right time here against Schalke. Out-farming as well on a Gragas. He's level 10 now. He's strong. He's a big boy.
He's what I wanted to get this to be, honestly, in this
game. This is just such a simple setup where it's based around Schalke not having any vision in the river in the first place. And they see them walk into the river and they're like, just wait. Like, they have to walk up here and get some vision in this bush at some point. And you use the Shen perfectly. Great setup from Raze as well. Trading kills, yeah, but showing some mechanics. Mm.
Perfect setups all across the board. And you know, I was following Raze in that fight, and he just walks up. Walks up and is just like, oh.
Dramatic pause.
Yeah, I had to cough. And then nothing connects, and he's just like, oh, they're already dead. Well, I still got all my abilities, so I guess I have to do something flashy now. I've got to show I'm contributing to the team.
See, that's what I hate about Thresh. Mm. You know, back in the day, you could use Lantern and it would hit everyone, like with the shield. So it was so easy to get assist in a fight. You just throw it in Lantern, shield everyone, and you would just get assist in fights.
Yep.
As a KDA player myself, it was really, really good. Now you only shield one guy. So it's very easy to walk into fights, if you don't enter the fight instantly, to actually not really get an assist, or maybe only get one. If you don't flash flay into like box, it's very hard to hit multiple guys. Mm. So if you are a KDA player, Thresh is probably not your pick. Sona, I can recommend.
Alistar.
Alistar's a great one, heal, assist on everyone. Karma, another great KDA pick. Thresh, not so much, also because you end up overextending often if you want to make the big plays, and then you're actually fairly squishy.
Do you know if Janna's passive Tailwind gives you an assist just by being near?
I'm not sure.
Because you are technically assisting because you're granting movement speed.
I'm pretty sure it used to do. I'm not sure anymore.
Okay. Because otherwise, that would be the MVP pick. You just need to be near the fight somewhat, and then you get an assist.
Yeah, I mean, again, on Sona, you literally cannot avoid it.
Yeah.
You're like, oh, I press one of my three buttons where I just roll my head across the keyboard.
Has
almost no cooldown, and I will hit something, either an ally or an enemy, and I will get that assist. Problem about Sona is you're very, very, very prone to miss your ulti.
Yeah.
And then you look like a fool because it's a very big ulti.
Saw that yesterday from Betsy, actually.
I mean, we've seen it a lot. It's the problem, right? You flash forward your ulti on Sona, and you miss, and people laugh at you.
Yeah.
Think of some of the hilarious moments of professional League of Legends. It's like Chouster on Sona, you know, flashing forward, missing that ulti. We all remember it.
The ex-Miffy. There's also
the
Yellow Star.
The Sejuani one. The Yellow Star.
The Yellow Star.
On the Thresh, where he missed everything.
In bottom tri-bush. There's been a lot of good moments.
Yeah. Definitely. A lot of funny fail moments.
I mean, for every Felix play where he quadges people on the tower, there's an equally funny play by pro players.
Happens very rarely.
More rarely than the big out players, yeah, unfortunately.
So.
We've got the good old... Oh, all right. Gets out there just in time. Got the good old fail flashes from time to time.
I like this build again from Betsy. I really think when you get early kills on Vladimir, get some early power, you know? Mm. Abyssal, extra damage, proto build. I want to see Rylai's. Maybe instead of proto build, a second item, but it is a good item. It gives you a lot of extra damage with your ulti as well. So it's a snowball build he's going for. And he's been getting early kills both games. Been very, very strong in both games, honestly. The Jhin has been working out as well. Like, Ghostblade, Duskblade, Jhin. Holy moly, man. I mean, I was about to say party time again, but I said it three times already.
That's still true.
It is such a good feeling playing two item Jhin. Because, like, just get one auto attack to proc the Duskblade, W into ulti, someone's gonna die. Like,
yep.
Someone is dead.
And he's been ahead every single game as well, out of the two that we played here. So he is just like, well, there's
every single game.
So there's no reason for him not just to go Duskblade and start popping people.
No, I mean, you only go for like a defensive item, like Hexdrinker, if you're against a lot of AP that's going to dive onto you. But
yeah.
Talia and Elise are not really going to dive onto you and deal magic damage like a LeBlanc or Kassadin will do that. So you can just go Duskblade. Have to be a little bit concerned about the Fiora if she gets to late game, but Steve, while he is farming really well, again, like last game, he's not able to get early kills. He needs more items before he really takes over the lane. Parang is once again on do not die duty, which he played pretty well last game.
Yeah, I think it was fine.
And now it's like when Memento yells, ult me, Parang ults him, and then you just engage with the Gragas and you win the fight. Talia might be able to ult here, wall them off so they can't retreat.
Gilles is looking for the flank, he lands the cocoon.
Is it for Schalke?
Rylai's is the one he's chasing after with the Culling.
Where's Talia? She's
coming in from Steve. He's going to try and assassinate Betsy, but he's got the Stand United on top of him. He's coming in, he's looking for this Shadow Dash, and he finds Steve for the instant kill from Steelback. Rylai's getting chased down. Spratto as well. Betsy over the wall, he's looking for an E. Parang is going to follow after. Spratto now cut off from the team. And Fox, he's behind everyone looking for a flank, but that was not the right time to be there. Now there's the TP's even cut off his escape. He knocks two people into him. Shadow Dash kill, 4-for-1. ROCCAT pulling ahead once again, Deficio.
Again, game one all over again. Big team fight in the mid lane. Another victory for ROCCAT. We said it in Champ Select Pulse. If you are ROCCAT, just keep drafting these strong team fighting comps. Because Schalke needs to show first they can be proactive and snowball before you change. Schalke showed again that they're not able to play the early game properly, set up their split pushers. They run very low engage compositions where they rely on these side lanes in 1-3-1s, but because they fall behind early, they lose mid lane control every single time. Well, then your 1-3-1 doesn't work. This is them trying to set up that fight. Talia ulti also ends up actually being behind ROCCAT or towards Schalke's base, so it doesn't really block anything, also due to a good flash. And now Steve gets caught a great snare from Steelback. That's one kill. Fight is now won already from ROCCAT because Betsy can move into the back line on this Vladimir. Schalke is showing today that they're not good enough at playing these 1-3-1 comps where they need to play proactive and snowball the early game. Because they're getting outplayed in these fights and in the early game by ROCCAT. And
yep.
We get another situation where a Vladimir is sitting with the Gragas in these team fights and just having the time of his life.
It's as you were saying in game one, Zephyr, right? Like, you have this 1-3-1 composition, and if you get ahead, it's just like, man, they just couldn't do anything against this composition. There's just nothing they could do. They were, like, the team was just splitting them up, and they cannot fight. However, when ROCCAT gets ahead and is able to force Schalke into these team fights, Schalke just not equipped for them, and also playing these fights badly is resulting in just fight after fight after fight going over to ROCCAT.
And boss, we talked about KDA supports.
Uh-huh.
And we talked about how hard it can be on Thresh to pick up these assists because everything you have like now is single target, unless you like flash plays, as we mentioned. Raze didn't get a single assist in the last fight.
Oh man, 1-1-1.
You're 1-1-1 and your team has 9 kills as a support. Man, that's a sucky feeling.
Sad state of affairs. Oh, Betsy is going to be knocked into Schalke. They may be able to get this pick off. No, he's into Sanguine Pool. Steelback zoning away with the Deadly Flourish as well. And a Hema Plague will heal Betsy back to 50% health. And he'll go vamp some more. So he's pretty good to go. ROCCAT took the top tower, gaining an even bigger advantage.
And time is running out.
It is.
Honestly, for Schalke.
Zonya's hourglass is running out.
A bit like last game, we need this big mistake from ROCCAT now where they overextend or they mess up a Baron call. Schalke comes in, you know, wins that one fight, gets a few kills on Steve, and then takes the Baron. Apart from that, you know, ROCCAT should be able to win these fights. And it's so tough. I mean, we're 24 minutes in and you're almost 10,000 gold down again. I'm saying almost. Obviously, it's 7K at the moment,
close
but
enough.
I consider that close enough at this point.
Round it up.
Yeah, it's what we do. 7 yeah. to 10. Whatever, it's 10.
There
it's
we go.
10. Don't have to do too much math here. Are you behind? Probably 10K gold.
Every time.
Every time.
Every single time. Man. So different from what I was expecting today. We've rehashed it time and time again. But how crazy
would remind people about
how crazy yeah.
Yeah, I expected,
not ours,
you know, that ROCCAT would
not
bounce back.
Desk as well. Yeah, I was 3-0 to ROCCAT, honestly.
I knew that ROCCAT, after the games yesterday, would go home, scrim some NA teams due to the time zone for the entire night, really improve, probably TSM they played against
sure.
or something. Improve a lot compared to it, fix some issues, and come in today really well prepared. Expected.
There was a little bit of doubt. Oh, Steve
oh.
over the wall, raise, he wants the KDA!
Give him the
Steve
assist.
Is gonna jump away, and unfortunately no kill for him today, but the rest of the team will secure the tower. Unfortunately, that does not enhance his KDA, and he's still 1-1-1.
That is the problem for Raze in this game. He doesn't care about winning. He needs some kills and assists here. You need to suddenly become the bloodthirsty support. Pick
yeah.
up the kills yourself. Your team doesn't want to give you any.
Just go one punch thrash where you just go full AD and you slap people with your
Infinity Edge
play
and everything.
Static Shiv as well. Fantastic. Whole lot of damage.
It is the ARAM build, I feel.
Yeah, it is. Same with Bard as well. You just build on hit abilities. Uh
oh,
Steve again. Doesn't land the hook this time. That's for a pass. He's going to sidestep pretty much everything. He's got his dancing shoes on, but it's not going to save him. Hema Plague is going to tick down. Memento getting shredded out. He's got no bleed on top of him. He should be surviving. Kerrang and Betsy staying amidst the fight, but no one actually died in that fight. Everyone's going to back off. Fairly healthy. Gideous, he's stepping up. Weaver's
Where are you going?
He's going to try and finish from Memento off here, but he's going to be dragged in by Raze so that he can finish off Gideous. But Fox is still looking for kills. There's the E looking to explode. He finds Raze. Steve as well looking to pick up these kills. That's three kills. Looking for this fourth one onto Betsy. He comes in with the E. Gideous is low. He just needs to scuttle away or rappel. Good team fight from Schalke. A 4-for-1.
Ooh, very important for Schalke here. Managed to catch ROCCAT. Look crazy at first. Haliyeh is diving towards the back line. Bought enough time for Steve to TP in. Survived, obviously, before going straight for Baron. 26 minutes into the game. Still down in goal. But it's only Perang alive. No teleports from any other member.
Get in there, Perang.
Ooh, can he buy enough time? He's a full tank Shen. Baron does a lot of damage. No one can really tank it on the side of Schalke. Gillis is on his way. Perang just needs to taunt them while Baron hits them.
Yep. Baron is not dying very quickly. Gillis only now just arrives. Perang is very scary. Fox is low. He'll have to flash over the wall. Lands the Q. Sprato and Steve as well. Dropping low. But that will be the kill onto
coming.
Perang.
They're coming
still
close.
Very, very low. Baron, 3,000 health. Raise and Memento. So
God,
incredibly
it's so
close.
Low.
It's going to become a 50-50. But it's Gillis who managed to get it. The hug over the wall. Sprato. It will allow Raze to get over the wall for the first kill. And looking for this next one to Sprato. But still, it's going to be worth Barrel. For Memento, picks up that kill, but the Baron for Schalke.
And now let's see what ROCCAT can do on the map. There's a big wave in the bottom lane. Rallus does have his ulti to go down and clear it out, and then suddenly Schalke, despite being this far down, ends up getting Baron. Won a team fight as well, after catching ROCCAT behind enemy lines and everything. That's the best Schalke could hope for in this situation,
yeah.
being this far down. Early in the game.
I want to attribute some of that to Fox as well, because I was he's flanking, picks up one kill, forces everyone into the rest of his
exactly.
team with his E coming out there. And
then Steve showed up.
Steve showed up, clean house. Schalke from that were able to go Baron, pick up another kill and the Baron itself. And even though they only have it on three members, that's enough to stall for the next couple minutes.
So this is the first chase against Steve here. So important he stays alive so he can actually TP back. He goes very low, has the ult from Vladimir as well on him, and then the heal from Rallus saves the day. That heal from Rallus was so important because it means Schalke can now chase. Ulti from Tilia coming in, behind ROCCAT now, forcing Memento to take the lantern. So they're all grouped up, and now TP from Steve. Just outside, and now Gilius.
He's getting caught up, body slam. Should be enough to finish him off, honestly,
with
here.
With a shield, he's dead.
Oh, no, Hema Plague is going to tick down. Goodbye, Gilius. And now ROCCAT will have to back off. They've got to be careful of Steve looking for the flank raise. He just stands still, looks for the death sentence, and Fox will be very happy to pick up the kill, but he goes too deep, gets caught out by the
all
deadly flurry. Betsy
by
coming in. And now he goes in to his Sanguine Pool. He finds a kill into Spraddle. I don't even know what that fight was. That was so messy from so many players, and every single one of them paid for it with their lives.
And ROCCAT, you know, still really far ahead. Three dragons, removed a lot of Baron buffs in that last fight. Steve is still the problem, but he needs that BT completed. And even then, it's hard for him to take down Parang in time, because he got almost destroyed Parang in a few seconds and forced someone from ROCCAT to go back and defend instead, so the rest of Schalke can make a play on the map. It's all right now on that Fiora split pushing and the big plays from Atalia.
Yeah.
That's basically it from Schalke. We haven't really seen many successful Talia ultis through the side lanes. You could imagine, you know, oh, Talia setting up the Fiora, you know, the super strong split push. But it's just not really worked out. Also, because ROCCAT have been able to win these early fights again. Betsy sitting on four fully completed items on Vladimir. Another Infernal Drake coming as well. And ROCCAT so far has been picking up everything. Except for that Baron.
Except for the Baron. But, I mean, in terms of the long game, picking up another Infernal Dragon, finding the Elder Dragon as well after 35 minutes would be massive for them.
So Schalke tried to siege against ROCCAT's teamfighting comp. So ROCCAT engaged straight away. Fresh in the front line with the Gragas. Take down the first target here. And then I actually like the fact that Schalke tries to chase back here. It's a 4v4 now. Raze tries to predict the Duke on the side. Goes down and then... Whoops.
Yep, deadly flourish.
Whoopsie, whoopsie, whoopsie.
A little bit too close, and that means Spraddle also pays for that mistake. Betsy finds another kill.
Classic one. Pull the support down with you. Yep. Ultimum steal back.
Third one, looking for the fourth one. Ultimate spreads apart. Schalke. Gilius is going to come back down, but immediately find Memento. Good cocoon, but Betsy is still following after. He's got the Tides of Blood. Oh, what a long-range deadly flourish from Steelback. That will secure the kill onto Gilius.
Did you know, Paul, Steelback is pretty good at League of Legends?
Yeah, he's pretty good. You were calling it a comfort pick, and yes it is. Yes, it is a comfort pick.
Oh, definitely is a comfort pick for him. And the rest of ROCCAT, they should be able to push for this mid tower. We keep talking about Steve in this side lane. If he's not able to dive on the tower and take down the Shen, then he's not really able to get enough pressure. That's another kill.
Oh, Fox just instantly dead. Betsy obliterates him under the tower. Memento's zoning away. He's going after both of the bot laners. Spraddle can't turn around. He's too low. Rallas has to watch his inhibitor die. It's 31 minutes. Steve's in top lane. And ROCCAT are looking to close out. There's no mid laner. There's no Gilius. He's respawning. Memento gonna assist taking down this tower.
And Parang is just stopping the recoil from Steve here. Gilius is alive.
It's gonna be
fight.
A 4 versus 3. They have to fight. They take down Raze. 3 versus 3. Can they do enough? Here comes the TP from both of the top laners. Gilius getting in there. He's gonna go down. Steve gonna try and defend the base as well. He does a lot of damage onto Steelback, but it's not enough. There is enough zoning from the team. Steelback turned around, executes him in style. And now ROCCAT are onto the Nexus. Sproul's the only one there to try and defend. Rallas can't do anything. And ROCCAT, against all odds, find two wins in this best of five.
And another game where they honestly outplay Schalke, especially in the early to mid game. It's the same kind of situation where ROCCAT draft, great scaling, you know, Gragas, Vladimir, get two items on Jhin, you know, you got these big spikes once you get past 20 minutes from multiple of their champions. And they don't get punished early on, at all.
Nope.
At all. They actually managed to get ahead in the early game. Again, just Shen ulti on the Vladimir. If you guys remember the mid lane, sneak in behind Talia. That's a kill. That's a second kill on Gilius. Win a fight in the river. And suddenly, you are really far ahead in gold with a team fighting composition versus a split pushing comp. it gets pretty easy then to win the game, and that's what ROCCAT are showing, despite that one mistake with a lost Baron. And that was it, one mistake.
I mean, it was just rinse and repeat from the first game really. I mean, this time we had that one good fight coming out from Fox, the one who really set it up. I was just taking a look at damage dealt. Fox did the most damage in the game, actually 26,000 damage out there. He did a good job for the team, but it just wasn't enough to pull back a victory because every single other fight just went really, really, really badly for Schalke. So, not looking good in this series, DeFicio, but with ROCCAT leading Schalke 2-0, let's head over to the analyst desk to break down just how this happened.
Thank you so much, Pulse. And against all odds and most of the predictions, ROCCAT 2-0 up over Schalke already. Honestly, I'm shocked. I didn't know, but I didn't expect this to happen at all. And I think it's scripted, and I think
that
all of us are.
Just weird.
I think looking at the team compositions here in the early game, it was a little bit odd. And I want to ask you, so despite the fact that ROCCAT won, we're consistently seeing this Thresh pick rise up. And you've told us off air repeatedly that you don't think this is the right choice. Why don't you think Thresh is the optimal support pick in this situation?
Yeah, for me, I would personally rather pick something like Bard or Taric or, I don't know, Tahm Kench. Because for me, Thresh can be countered really easily. So I only use it as a counter pick to like Bard or something. But I think Taric would be pretty good because they had like Vladimir and Gragas, so he can just engage, and then with Taric ult they can never die. And then I don't know what Thresh did this game, but yeah, I don't think it's a good pick.
TLDR, bad pick, yo.
TLDR, and of course it does work out for them, but there was also some interesting decisions on the side of Schalke. Now, I know you guys both have a decent amount of playing with Taliyah around, obviously something your team has picked up. What does Taliyah need to do in like the early to mid game to be relevant? Because I don't think we saw much from Fox this time around.
Should I take it?
Yeah, do it.
Okay. So the beauty about Taliyah is that you can always push the lane, and that kind of gives your jungler it kind of gives him an edge that he can always invade and they can always be proactive, you know? So we now see a little play where it kind of backfired after this. But the beauty about Taliyah is obviously you can push, right? So what they want to do is they want Gidius to constantly play aggressive, invade enemy jungle, and put pressure on the enemy team. And then they obviously want to roam to side lanes and put pressure. And I saw them do it like one time on the Shen where Taliyah ulted up to the Shen and put pressure on him, and I think Steve had a lead in CS, so that was kind of their goal with the Taliyah Elise, where they just want to do a lot early, but they couldn't really execute it properly, and if you fall behind with these kind of champions, it's really hard to come back.
And I think the one thing that we've been seeing is that Schalke are making moves to try to get ahead in this series, but it never seems to work out. And then every time ROCCAT are getting a lead, they are absolutely obliterating the opposition. We saw their average season gold leads coming up 500 gold over the course of the regular season, average in their wins. These last two games, over 600 at 20%. Average gold over the course of the regular season, more than 3,000 in their ability to win. So, like, just insane how much ROCCAT have picked it up here. Do you think that this is Schalke underperforming, or did ROCCAT just realize after those losses yesterday that they needed to step it up?
I think it's probably a mix of things, but honestly, it's just, I know everyone is talking about it, this with Schalke, it's like, if they don't get early leads and don't seem to know what to do specifically in-game to come back, and that is a huge problem, and I don't think they have solved that through the season and are not showing here at least. So.
Well, what we've seen a couple of times is that they put themselves in that position. I asked production to pull up that replay of the failed dive in the beginning again, because we talk so much about Gilius, but it's not like we're pulling this out of thin air. It happens over and over, and you wanted to highlight specifically how...
Yeah, this is not... as we maybe look to pull that one up one more time, you can see that just over-aggression that comes in from Schalke. Fox consistently mispositioned in the lane, and ROCCAT now have such an easy time punishing out each time this happens. And for Gilius, a guy who's really been struggling over the course of this series, he's had 18% of his deaths for the entire season, including promotion tournament, in this series alone. That's pre-15, so that's pretty gross. Like, that's not where you want to be in a promotion game.
I think that... The problem here is that they're forcing around mid, where honestly they want to force around the Shen and pressure the Shen so he can't use his ulti and impact the map. And then slowly they will get the Fiora ahead and he can win and split, and they can put pressure that way around. But I want to see Schalke pick more scaling compositions and fight ROCCAT in the mid game's team fight. But if they draft like this, there should be no way that ROCCAT lose teamfights with Gregas and Vladimir against Elise and Talia.
And I mean, they didn't. They continued to win teamfights as we look at like the way that they played throughout the rest of the game. You can see that they just continued to out-execute, continued to just obliterate the competition. Now, do you think that if Schalke let it up in the early game one more time, are ROCCAT just going to be able to 3-0 this series?
Yeah, I think they have the momentum.
Nice one.
Yeah, I think they play better as a team right now. And I don't know what's happened with Schalke, but yeah, I think ROCCAT has the edge right now.
Yeah, so you guys have the famous Yamato with his famous speeches. So if he was the Schalke coach, tell me what he would tell them now.
And your best Yamato impression,
yeah,
too.
I think Miki should take this one.
Pressure's on.
I don't want to do it. Okay. Okay, forget about the last game. Focus on the next one. Last game. Previous game does not matter.
Pretty solid advice, I say.
Something about that, yeah.
Yeah, pretty solid
something
advice.
Something like that.
Well, ROCCAT is up 2-0, so we'll see if they can close it out. And we do also want to take a look into what's happening over on stream one, Origin versus Misfits. And I think we're going to get a live look into that match because as opposed to the first game, Misfits ran away with this game, as we saw. What was the main thing that went different for them here in comparison to game one?
I think overall they had a more solid draft. I feel like the Trundle pick is a really big trap for both teams, because it seems like both teams have the Gnar prepared for it. And on the other hand, we have Hansama, who is a really good Lucian player. And if you play Sivir Trundle against Lucian Karma, there is no way you're gonna win that lane. You will just get smashed in the lane. So I want OG to go away from the Trundle pick and maybe bait Misfit into it again. But overall, better drafting, and they seem to not be hesitating on that place.
Yeah, we saw a little bit earlier in this game. We might have that replay for you guys later. Hansama, 4 versus 5, just got a quadra kill or a triple kill, just cleaning everything up. He is living up to his name in this game, at least. So
I wasn't completely wrong.
No. And Misfits look like they will be evening it up, but it's not over yet. So you can go over to ELCS1 and check the tail end of that game out. For us, though, we are going to recall and buy some wards because we're good supports. But don't go anywhere. When we come back, we'll get Vision on Game 3 between Schalke and ROCCAT as we hear them screaming because things are going down on ELCS1. Before we head off, ROCCAT Steelback explains his mindset heading into today's best of 5.
I don't know, I never really feel nervous anymore. Like, I respect everyone, but I don't fear anyone. So I'm not really nervous because I know I can do it personally. Like, I know I can outperform my opponent. So I'm not really afraid of myself. But then as a team, it's different because we need to be on the same page together.